Welcome to The Art of Adventure. This is episode 296 with Dara Dubinet. The Art of Adventure is the podcast where we look at adventure, entrepreneurship, peak performance, metaphysics, and human potential. I'm your host, lead explorer, and guide, Derek Loudermilk. You can go to DerekLoudermilk.com to check out the show notes for this episode. And gosh, we are almost at 300 episodes. When I first started this show 5 or 6 years ago, I can't even remember, I said I'm going to do 300 episodes, and now we're getting very close. And so this is a great time for us to evaluate where the show is going to headed. Yes, I'm still going to keep doing the show. I still want to do it. It's awesome. It's really fun. But if you have any input, if you have any guest suggestions, or if there's topics that you'd like to see more of, you know, this show today is part of our series, our metaphysical series, looking at different modalities. So yeah, let me know if there's anything in particular, any conversations that you think we need to be having that The Art of Adventure is the right show to have them on, then would love to hear from you. You can send me an email, you can hit me up on Instagram, however that works best for you. All right, today's guest is Dara Dubinet, and we are going to be talking about astrogeography or astrocartography, astrology and maps, astrology and the science of place on the planet. A business colleague of mine recommended that I check out Dara's work. And I found it very fascinating because each person, right, everybody has their own astrology. And combining this with where on the planet you are, there's, you know, different vibes to different places, and different people are going to experience different parts of the earth differently. And one thing about this is you'll hear me ask about how astrology works. And I actually went back after we recorded this episode to learn a little bit more because I wanted to bring a little bit more science to astrology. And so basically the simplest way I can explain it is if you think of astrology itself like a map of our solar system and a map of the entire galaxy, even the Milky Way. And there are different fields of energy. There's different wavelengths or densities of energy that as the Earth passes through these different locations, through these different fields, basically all living organisms will experience different fields as they pass through them. So think of it like a bunch of nested balls or a bunch of concentric geometries that if the Earth and the solar system are passing through these fields, you're going to experience something different. So astrology is basically a map or a record of what you would be experiencing as you pass through these different fields. So that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about different places on Earth, how you can use astrogeography and astrology to help understand, you know, what you might experience if you travel to different places. And because this is a show about adventure and so many of you listening are travelers, I thought this would be especially relevant. So what you're going to hear is, you know, her explanation of how this all works, and she's going to read my chart. So you'll hear some very specific terms. You know, she's talking about the North Node and different lines on the planet and how, you know, how these lines influence. You know, she's got specific recommendations based on my chart, you know, where I might experience different things, like what would it be like if I were to go to the Western United States, for example. So this show is going to be a really interesting introduction if you've never experienced this concept before, or if you've heard about it but you haven't dug in at all. This is a great place to sort of get a basic understanding, and there's a free tool online where you can go and you can look at your own chart and you can apply some of the things that she's talking about and see what your own chart, where you might like to travel and experience different energies on planet Earth. And of course, right now we're in the middle of the quarantine as I'm recording this, the COVID-19 pandemic. So if you can't travel, you can also basically take yourself there by meditating. You can get the right energy by a meditation practice. And she tells you how to do that as well. Dara's got a course where you can dive even deeper if you still want more after this episode. I went through that course before we recorded this interview, which was also very helpful. Thank you, Dara, for that. So anyway, this is a bit longer than normal intro, but without further ado, here is Dara Dubinet. Dara Dubinet, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you, Derek, for having me.
We're going to be talking about astrogeography, and you might not even know how I came to find you. I was having a conversation in a business mastermind about sacred sites around the world and how different locations had certain energy or power to them. You know, you feel that when you're there. It could be like a university or the Great Pyramids or Machu Picchu or wherever. And someone said, oh, that's called geomancy. And so It reminded me of this astrology, this AstroClick site that a friend showed me a while back, and it had looked at it. So then I found the term. So there's this term geomancy and then this term astrogeography. And you were the first person that came up when I searched for astrogeography. And I was like, oh, you're actually doing this. You've got a course about it. Super interesting. So I just reached out and, you know, because I wanted to learn about it. And it really fits with the things I'm doing with the podcast right now, just exploring like different alternative healing and performance enhancing modalities and just investigating all these different things. So that's how I came to get in touch with you, first of all.
Yeah, that's awesome. I commend you on reaching out. And I feel from what I've seen from what you do is that we are in similar paths. Like, it seems to me that you're helping people to break out of whatever confinement they're in, to have adventure and to be the hero or heroine of their own lives. And you've actually stumbled upon more than the astrogeography, because I do sessions for people. It's not ongoing coaching sessions, although if they need me, I'm here. But I consider myself to be a life direction specialist. So it's not only when I go to help people and help them figure out which direction to follow with conviction, because that's the best thing in the world, I like to see their astrogeography, because first I want to understand what planetary energies they're living in now, like what's going on around them. So I'm going to explain a lot, but I'm really glad that you reached out to me. I saw your face. I saw your Instagram. I was like, I love what he's doing. There's so many possibilities out there for us that when we position ourselves in a different place on the planet, or we visit the place, there's three choices. You can either relocate, which not everybody can do. You can go visit a new place, soak in the energies that are there for you in that place, the potentials. And I'll explain what that means in a second. Or in this day and age, we're so lucky that we can activate our businesses or find love or do all kinds of human potentials in different places while sitting at our desks or on our sofa. So I call that as tapping into the energy. So I don't want people to feel like, oh, I'm living where I am, I'm happy, I don't need this. It's like, well, are you having enough sales for your business? If not, maybe you want to look to a Mercury line, Mercury midheaven line. If you want more fame and reputation, let's say you're doing all this beautiful work, but not enough people are seeing it. Well, if you look to a sun line on the planet, anywhere that the sun line is, that could be a place where you could get an agent or be publicized. So it's really good for manifestation of any particular thing you need at any particular point in your life. And life is always changing and we're always growing and evolving. So I think that I'm all about staying current. And I know, I imagine everybody's interested in what is astrogeography? What is this? What are you guys talking about? And it's basically the astrology of place. Like, most people have heard that they have a natal chart. The natal chart is particular to them. They have sun, moon, rising somewhere. Their Venus is in Libra or it's in Taurus, all of that stuff. To me, it's just this beautiful language. They're symbols and you get to tell a story. And for me, astrology is just helpful for knowing ourselves, knowing what's going on, and then navigating accordingly. It's a tool, right? It's just a tool. And it's so exciting. So basically, there's the natal chart. And then the same thing for your astrogeography. There's a chart of the map of the world at the moment you were born. So the sun was rising somewhere and the moon is somewhere. And so it's a snapshot. So your astrogeography is particular to you. I call it astrogeography. It has been since many, many, many years ago, people have done astrolocality, and it was very labor intensive to do. And in the 70s, I think it was the 70s, a man named Jim Lewis took this very obscure and laborious technique and made it accessible for us to do on the computer. And he trademarked it astrocartography. So you'll find that sometimes it's called astrology of place, or I'm calling it astrogeography. Some people might call it something else, but it's really the astrology of place. And the map is the map of the world with all these colorful lines on it that tell you what energies you're going to have in any given place. I just find it, it's potential energies. So for example, there is a heartbeat of a place. There's the ley lines of a place. I think I'm on a particularly good one in Venice, California. I think there's magic here. If I place myself in Santa Monica, it's going to feel different to where I live in Venice. I felt that I needed to be here in this place on my Jupiter rising line. And I'll explain how I found and why I'm so obsessed with this, because I want everybody to know their astrogeography. I feel like it's really important and it's a tool that we can all use. It's on astro.com, and I've also developed this course so you can learn what it means. Like, some people look at this and they're like, what is this? It looks crazy. It looks complicated. And so I explain each of the planetary lines and the four angles that those lines might be. And so I kind of have this gift to take obscure information and ground it to make it simple in a way that's like, ah, I can do this. It makes sense. So that's kind of what I do. And the other thing that I like to do is that I'm doing sessions for people. And I know that I can't read for everybody. I always want people to do it themselves. You know what I mean? To be able to feed yourself. It's that give a man a fish line, like give him a fish or teach him how to fish. So when all of those years I did raw food on YouTube, and I wanted everybody to understand this is easy, like this lifestyle is easy and here's what you do. Now, what happened was do you need me to explain anything more about astrogeography?
Well, actually, so maybe some of my listeners may be more familiar with astrology. I'm unfamiliar with astrology. I have an astrologer friend who read my charts for my wife and I, which was really cool to hear him. And I, you know, like there were certain things that stuck with me that were helpful and the rest just sort of, I don't remember. But actually what I'm curious about right now is, so when we're born, like all the bodies in our solar system are arrayed in some spatial relation to each other. And my understanding is that they all have some sort of like electromagnetic connection to each other. But I'm curious if there's any explanation for like how this imprints a human. What's the mechanism for affecting us?
Well, the simplest way I can describe it is that the moon, just like the moon, when the moon is full or it's waxing or it's waning, affects the ocean. It affects us because we're bodies of water. So, you know, when the sun is out, you feel different when the moon is out. I can't really explain the technical aspects of the astrogeography. I think we're going to find you somebody who likes to get very, very technical with that. It's the premise that we are affected by, let's take the moon, you know, that we are affected by the moon. People get crazy when the moon is full, and you know what I mean? Like it's a building growing phase as the moon is getting fuller. So it's more just the understanding that wherever the planets are, that they affect us. They affected us at the moment of our birth. What planet was rising tells us how we're going to present or show to the world. Where the moon was when we were born, for example, the moon was in Cancer when I was born, so I'm very Cancerian and nurturing. It's kind of language to describe that moment that our souls chose to come in, like the snapshot or the energetic thing that happened. It's a soul's choice. So I am looking at it from a psychological, like, evolutionary, like this is the information, this is what your soul chose, this is the snapshot. It's like a blueprint for your life. And it doesn't mean that it stays and you can never grow. And it's never like, it's not predictive anymore. A lot of the old astrology comes off as like strange, because in the past it was used to predict weather, predict happenings. And now it's more with evolutionary astrology used as a tool to understand ourselves better. There's a great astrologer named Stephen Forrest, and he explains it so beautifully in his books. But it's a language, and it's, for me, storytelling. For me, it's a way, because I'm doing these guidance intuitive sessions for people, it gives me clues, very fast clues to who they are, who they chose to be at the moment of birth, and what they can do to navigate, to accentuate their positive traits and work with the ones that might be a little more challenging. So for me, my thing is not so much interested in the evidence, or my evidence with all of this has been played out in my life. And then all the sessions I do for people, and it just works. Like for me, it's like, you know, I just have a knowing about things. I have a quick splenic knowing of what is correct and what's not. I'm not the heady intellectual that's going to go back in and figure out, well, is this really true? I personally know it to be true. And then what I say is, look at the map yourself and see. Like, I've had so many people say, oh my gosh, like, I've had so many stories. Like, you know, I told this couple when she's like, we're going to go here, we're going to go here, we're moving here for a while. I'm like, there's a potential for some serious arguments on that line. And a year later, a friend of hers told me she had the worst year with her husband because it was a Mars descending line. So it's kind of my job to give the story of what I see. And then people have to feel it out for themselves. And it's proven to be in my sessions on point and in my own life, which I'm happy to share my story, if that helps. I wish I could give you more like, yes, this and that and technicalities, but it's not really where I come from.
That's okay. And it would take some research to like fully understand it. So it's probably helpful. This Stephen Forrest is helpful thread.
It's very technical. And he breaks things down beautifully, and there's people who have that bent, but he's also somebody that would say, science or evidence is based on numbers and facts, and this is just symbols and a language that we use to see into ourselves more. So it takes more than the head, it takes the heart, it takes the, let me see if this is going to work for me. Does this ring true? That's all. If I tell you that you are born on a line that would make partnership important to you and that there is a spiritual bent to how you see things, then you would say that's true or it's not. We could say, I have so many stories that are running through my head.
Well, I'd love to hear your story. Yeah. You got to California and you used to be somewhere else.
Okay. And I just want you and your viewers to know that when I do sessions or when you watch the astrogeography course, you'll get a visual for what we mean. It's very colorful and I explain it very basically. In the sessions, I share the screen and I record it so you can go back because it's a lot of information.
We've got a lot of travelers that listen to the show, a lot of digital nomads, and so all like looking at the map and thinking like, where can I go? And sometimes, you know, it's word of mouth, like we're all going to Vietnam this summer and it's gonna be awesome. You know, sometimes it's that way, but this is like another way to pick a place.
It's another way to plan your trip. I did a beautiful double reading for a motorcycle man and his partner in crime for they were going from Germany down to Africa and back around again on their motorcycles, and I planned out their trip with them, and it wasn't to deter them from going anywhere. It was to say, okay, when you hit here, mind your passport. No, you'll have delays. When you hit here, she might be upset and you might feel good. Like I was able to tell them what they were going to, so that people often go, oh, I'm not crazy for feeling the way I'm feeling. Like it makes sense. I'm getting chills now. It's like this feeling of like, that makes sense. And like, maybe you don't want it. Maybe you're not in the mood for explosive Pluto energy and you don't want Saturnian stuff. So while all your friends may be going somewhere, maybe internally, it intuitively, it doesn't feel right for you. And now you can know why. Or you can get confirmation, like when you're always been dreaming of going somewhere, you can see why and what that energy holds for you. And I believe that we all have lessons to learn while we're here. So if you chose a challenging line to be born on, it's kind of like, or live on or travel to, it's kind of like when a grain of sand or a parasite or something's injected into a clam or a mussel and the irritant makes the pearl, right? Like sometimes we need the irritant in order to grow. So nothing is bad and nothing is good. I will say that I had a wonderful astrogeography teacher who was more black and white. You never go near a Saturn line. You don't go near a Mars line. And I'm like, well, you know, if I know their north node, their soul's wish, which I can explain. Another thing that I'm completely like the wow, like if you're coaching people, I would say you'd want to know their north node because it literally tells you what their soul wishes them to reach and stretch for in this lifetime. What if somebody needs to be more Capricorn, which is more serious and disciplined and out in the workforce, than being near a Saturn line because Saturn rules Capricorn would really help them. So I have a more like open approach, but yes, you're in this day and age. And I think one of the reasons I was propelled to develop this course is that so many people are now able to live all over the world or travel or do business with people in different places. Like we need this now more than we needed it 20 years ago when I first heard about it.
Yeah, and at some point we'll have teleportation, and then you really can just like pop to a place that's...
Let's get a little Jupiter expansiveness and fortune. Let's have people throw money at my feet and carry me. I'd like a little bit of that, and then we go there. But in the meantime, if we don't go there, we can choose to just, you know, when you stop listening to this podcast and you learn where your Jupiter line is and you go, let's say you're like, let's say it's in Poland. You don't have to go to Poland. You can start looking at imagery. You can just Google, let me see what this looks like here, and just absorb some of that energy as if you are transporting yourself. It is like teleportation. Sitting and meditating, like we all know that we can sit and meditate and remember what it's like to feel the hot sun baking on us while we're lying in sand. It's the same thing. If it's Italy, you listen to Italian music, you eat some Italian food, you know, you can put yourself there. I can return myself to the places that held the most beautiful energy for me at a moment's notice. And I think that's part of the exciting thing. And adventure. And you're all about expansion for people, for their notions of what's possible. And this expands the notion of what's possible. Because I will tell you, living on one line, meaning living in, let's say, Florida, where I was living on a Neptune line, is very, very different than where I'm living now in California on my Jupiter line. It's like night and day. So I can explain my little story. Okay, so it goes like this. Born in Livingston, New Jersey, born on a Pluto line, Pluto rising. I am like Pluto herself. I'm all about transformation and change. Pluto is that. I'm an agent of change in a beautiful, happy way. I'm showing people how to eat, how to declutter their homes, how to do feng shui, how to do astrogeography. I'm like, come on, everybody, let's make some change. Let's stay current. Let's move some energy. That's Pluto. And so the line that you're born on, or the lines that you're born on, make up your character. Your soul chose to be born there. That kind of stays with you. Although living on a Pluto line forever is kind of hard. I ended up getting married and moving to Florida, where I ended up getting divorced. Then I ended up getting married again. And if I tell you I had more spiritual lessons and more, which is Neptune, and more this feeling of kind of being underwater, like I couldn't be seen or I couldn't get creative projects done. And I am a very prolific artist. I've painted murals. I've had jewelry business. I am always creating something. But I just felt like I couldn't get anything done. In my second marriage, I had a baby, and that marriage didn't go well, but the baby did. And I signed a piece of paper saying I wouldn't leave Palm Beach County till she was 18. And I tried to make it work. But somehow I was there going, this is just not my place. Like, I don't feel my future here. It was like a life sentence almost. Like, I felt like I was dying a slow death down there. And I'm like, in Palm Beach County, like, till she's 18, I'll be 52, which is the age I am now. And what kind of mother will I be feeling stuck? So a friend of mine invited me out to California. And it was this magical weekend, the Venice canals, the plum wine at the beach. We went for a hike in, I don't know, one of the canyons. And I came home and I was like, I have to go back. So I went back again the next time I didn't have my daughter. And then I came back and I said to, I had an amazing astrologer. And I said, you know, I would just do check-ins with her. And I just said, I feel so happy in California. I feel so pretty in California. I feel so creative in California. Like, what? And she told me, oh, let me look. And she said, well, of course you do. You're on your Jupiter line. I'm like, what's that? It's astrocartography at the time, or astrogeography, whatever she called it. And she said, no wonder you're on a Neptune line, which is like literally Neptune's the god of the sea. It's like being underwater. Sometimes there's magic. There's a mermaid flashing by, or a treasure box. But most of the time, it's just you're under the water, and it can be dark and gray and not so easy to see things clearly. It can lead to kind of delusion and being a little deceived here and there and not seeing clearly. It's not the sun. It's under the sea. I was like, I think I need to move there. And if I tell you, that's like a big deal. You have like a baby and you want to move 3,000 miles away. It's a whole thing. But I kept going out to California, and I remember bringing California energy back with me. And of course, there's a map of California on my wall, and I'm having California like tapping in as I say to that energy. She said, when you get to California, thousands of people are going to want to hear what you have to say. So when I finally did get to California, and that was magic, Jupiter itself. Jupiter is the planet of expansion and joy and optimism and faith. So I was the same little me in Florida, and the same little me moved to California, And all of a sudden I'm like, what do I do? And it was a big deal to get there. I think nothing short of magic, checking in with the moon and stars with her and checking in to make sure that it was right for everyone involved. It wasn't like I'm doing this no matter what. It was like, is this okay for everybody? And I had a vision that it was. So I did get out here, and everybody else is also happy out here. I'm happy to report 18 years later, like super happy this is the place. Daughter, ex, everything's good. But at the time, it was definitely like I was a pioneer. Like it was a little bit out there. So what happened was I got here and I decided to metalsmith and do jewelry. And a publicist called me and said, I want to represent you. She was one of the top ones. I was in every trade magazine. I was doing well with my jewelry business.
Oh, cool.
Until I found raw food. And I decided I wanted to do raw food, and then I decided to go to culinary school, and then I met an Oscar-winning actor, and then I worked with him for a year to do raw food with him, and then I said I have to make videos, and sure enough, I did videos, and everybody wanted to watch them on YouTube, and so what she said came true. On my Jupiter line, I was the same me, but my energy was different. I was seen more, so that is completely the way it is. When I go back to Florida, my Neptune line, I don't feel creative. I feel it's dreamy. I can't see clearly. I know when it's time to leave. So it's absolutely true. And for all the people I've done sessions for, they're like, this maps out the story of my life. Like this maps out where I come from, where I'm thinking of going. Even who I love, like the people you're attracted to very often are from your Venus descending line, you know? So I've had people who've had investors approach them from their Jupiter descending line. So Jupiter's expansion and opportunities, when it's on the angle of the descending, that's other, it's you being Jupiter and other people throwing it back at you. So that could be investment and money. And so it's really like been on point with everyone I've spoken to. That's my evidence.
That's super cool.
Yeah.
As I was thinking about myself, we've lived in several different countries. As a family, I lived in several countries before I met my wife and had kids. But both times we were in Bali together, we conceived kids. And then both of them were born back here in the States, in St. Louis. And so, you know, thinking about astrology, I was like, oh, there's got to be something, you know, like, why are they choosing not to be born in Bali? Or why are we conceiving every time we go there? Now we're worried about, we don't want to go back because we don't want another kid and all this.
That's funny. I looked at I have all my notes on you because I did look up all these beautiful places you've been. You were in Bali, they were conceived, and you have a lot of masculinity in Bali. You have a Mars line there. So that's like lust, passion, masculinity. You know what I mean? That's like Mars is how you get out into the world. It's almost like sperm swimming against it. It's strong. Mars is a strong placement that you wouldn't want to stay on forever, maybe. It gives you a lot of ambition. And your wife has the moon's node descending there. So she's able to really put aside her own need on that line. That is the central theme is partnership and putting another person's needs as important as your own. It's a really nice drive for you and karmic fated place for her. The moon's node is karma. And then they were born in St. Louis.
Yeah, which is where
I love that you're back there. I love that you're back there. It's very evolved for you to be back there, and I'm happy to describe why. So you have the moon's node, which makes it karmic and fated. You have that same line that she had in Bali, where it need to be in a relationship. It's like perfecting relationship. It goes really with, I don't know if we're going to talk about this, but I would love to kind of get everybody a heads up on what the North Node is, because it's your dharma in this lifetime. It's literally, to me, the most important thing in astrology. There's so many beautiful things that make up who you are, but the North Node is the major, like, spiritual shining star. You act according to your North Node, your spirit's going to be happy, opportunities are going to come. Yours is in Gemini, just so you know.
Okay, so let's real quick for the listener. I sent Dara my birth time and date and, you know, all the stuff you need for astrology and my wife's. And so what you guys will be hearing is me hearing it for the first time as well. So you can be like a fly on the wall. And yeah, I'm happy to discover about the North Node too.
Yeah. I'm sorry if it sounds too complicated for anybody who's listening. All you need to know is that I broke it down really simply in the two courses that I have available. They're very accessible. They're very easy to understand. You can easily look up your North Node and you can easily figure out your astrogeography. So basically, you have in St. Louis lovely lines. One might be a little bit challenging. So you can ask me where you want me to look first. I know you lived in California. If you're in Los Angeles or San Diego, it's pretty stellar. I don't know how you felt there.
That's where my wife is from, and we were staying with her family for several months. I didn't feel one way in particular there, actually. I can't really...
Was that because you were staying with someone's parents?
Yeah, probably.
So it's like, that's always interesting. But you do have a Jupiter rising line, as you can see if your map is open. You have Jupiter, you have Uranus, which is the planet of like, it's colorful, it's new technology, and you have Venus descending. So it's really, that whole swath that you see is pretty stellar for you. So maybe not in the parents' house, but on your own, it could be really fun. I'd have to look at her chart, maybe her. When we're in a partnership, we kind of get our partner's energy too. That's why it's important to look at both, because even though you might be feeling stellar, if she's having some difficulties, then it can affect you and vice versa.
Yeah. And so one of the questions I was going to ask you was, we also want our kids to experience a lot of time in the mountains. So we have this big list of mountain towns, you know, small mountain towns in the US where we could have a second home. Ranging from like Oregon and Montana to Idaho, Colorado, Arizona. And so I don't know if you have anything that could like point us.
You are stellar in Colorado. Through the middle of Colorado is Venus descending, which is, when I say Venus, that means you're a Venusian. That means that you're your most beautiful. You're feeling your most attractive. Then because it's a descending line, you're projecting it out into the world. And it comes back to you on this particular line through a partner. So you will feel beautiful. She'll feel good being around you. It's a love line. It's love, romance, the arts. It's everything beautiful in this world. Then you have that Uranus rising line, which Uranus is the planet of surprises. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad, but it's always colorful. It also rules like you being interested in technology and new ways to help humanity move forward, which is exactly what you're doing. That's a U line. And then you have what I have smack through. These three are smack through the middle of Colorado, and you have Jupiter rising. So thousands of people will want to hear what you have to say there. Your unique Amazing. Ideas, your unique ideas, you'll present them beautifully. And this is stellar. So when we look
and
at
I've
these
never
lines,
really wanted to go
it's
there,
a swath. it's strongest on the line, but there's an orb of influence. It's like maybe 600 to the west, 600 miles to the west, 600 miles to the east. So you have pretty much the middle of the United States unafflicted by anything troublesome. You're good. Yeah, you're really good. The only tricky part for you would be like east coast of the states. So we're all like, when we're evolved and we're really following our path as you're helping people do, you kind of, and we're eating clean enough so that we can hear our own intuition, then we kind of know, we have a knowing. I believe we're all intuitive. And then this just gives you like the yes, this is like wide open for me and I can go explore and then feel. So after you find out your astrogeography feels benefic, feels good to you, like it seems like something you would like, then you go to the area and then you feel the heartbeat of a place. You feel the ley lines. You feel where the magic is. That's where it comes in to really start using like, paying attention to what lifts your heart and your spirit and what doesn't. And that's the exploratory, like traveling fun.
Cool. So let me mention now Portugal. That's where we lived this year. We lived there for 3 months. And people always ask, how was Portugal? What, wherever we go, they say, oh, how was it? Portugal was wonderful, except that we didn't really enjoy it that much. Like every day was great, but the overall, we didn't build a community there. So it wasn't exactly what we were expecting, or it didn't feel as much like home as some of these other places, like Croatia really felt amazing for us.
Oh, Croatia's good. Croatia for your wife has like nothing. And what that means is there's never nothing, because we're looking at major longitudinal lines. Then there's latitudinal lines. Like if a line, I'm going to show you because we're on video. I can show you that. So basically, when you have no longitudinal lines, major lines affecting you, and you can't see anything within that area. So your wife doesn't have Croatia. Was it better in Hungary by any chance? Because she moves a little closer to some stronger benefic lines. Did you feel a difference for her in Croatia versus Hungary?
I actually would say that we both preferred Croatia to Hungary.
Okay. Could be the energy of the place. What's going on? Is there enough high vibe situations and people and food and whatever feels good to you? But that area is good because she has, let me just look here really quick. I'm looking at yours. Yours has Chiron rising, and I'm pretty sure that's affecting you. When we hang up, I'm going to show you how to measure to know how far away one line will affect you. But you have some Pluto descent there. You have some strong, like, revolutionary. Did it feel intense in any way?
Not that I recall, but. And sorry, what is Chiron really quick? I'm not familiar with that one.
I'll tell you. You have Venus there, which is where you would feel your most beautiful and handsome. And you also have Uranus descending. So that's like individuality and freedom in relationship, like a certain independence, encouraging independence. And then the Pluto may or may not have affected you. We'll have to measure it. But it sounds like you felt the Venus. And then Chiron is a magical, the symbol is shaped like a key. Chiron unlocks the place where we were wounded. And that sounds painful, right? Like who wants to look back and see where they're wounded? Well, anybody who wants to address it, to heal the wound and put the Band-Aid on or let the air heal it. Sometimes we have to like lift our wounds out of the deep, dark box so that we can heal it and get this. Chiron also unlocks the key to the special magic we have to offer the world. So usually the places where we've had a rub or a wounding, that's where we have the pearl of wisdom. So if you are trying to dial in, when I'm helping people dial in, what is their dharma, which direction should they go on? That's one of the keys that I look at. And a Chiron line will help you see that. So if you are healing or helping others in any way, it would give you language to your own wound and then therefore help you to help others.
Is Chiron an asteroid or what is it?
Yeah, I think Chiron's an asteroid. I don't think Chiron's a planet. I know how to describe it mythologically for you. Chiron is it's a really cool story, but I don't know if you want to go there. Because we might want to cover more in the map.
Yeah, let's talk about the map. I'll look up Chiron because I'm curious. Okay.
I think it's an asteroid. The moon's nodes also, when you see the little moon's node, it's not a planet. The moon's nodes aren't a planet. They are a mathematical point where the sun is orbiting the earth, where it intersects with the moon orbiting the sun. It's like a whole mathematical point thing, but it's considered to be an axis. And the north and south nodes describe, the north node describes your dharma, where you're headed, and the south node describes your karma, where you've been, and is one of the most insightful things I've ever come across.
Okay, let's talk about the North Node.
I need to talk about the North Node. So the North Node is my mathematical point. And that's all technical, and you can look into that. But basically what it tells you is that your North Node is your dharma. Like if you act according to the sign of your North Node, your spirit is going to be happy. When you're happy, you're vibrating at a higher level. People can feel it. They offer you opportunities. So the North Node, let's say, like yours, is in Gemini. Whenever you behave like a Gemini, your spirit's going to be happy. That's the what. You behave like a Gemini, meaning you will have the North Node is so the North, that's the North Node, our dharma. And then directly opposite always is the South Node. And the South Node is our karma, where we've been in past lifetimes. If you don't believe in past lifetimes, it's the first 30 years of this lifetime. What I feel is past lifetimes, you drag the karma into this lifetime, and we are our South Node behavior for about the first 30 years of our life. We start getting the North Node calling at about age 30 after our Saturn return. in our 20s, late 20s, which is always a tricky time. And we start to feel like we're different and we're changing. And we have the little fire that lives within us gets brighter. And the voice of like that intuition of what you could be gets stronger. And it's a reach and a stretch to follow your North Node because it's so different from what your South Node, what you've been many lifetimes. So for example, your North Node is in Gemini. And there's certain attributes that you would need to do to behave more Gemini. And that would make your South Node, it's always opposite, it's 180 degrees apart. Your South Node would be in Sagittarius. So get this, the South Node in Sagittarius for past lifetimes in the beginning of this one would have made you a world traveler, just a world traveler who was willing to leave home in order to search for higher spiritual truth. So up until about age 30, you're on point. You're in your South Node. You're gathering information from the world. And if you stayed traveling and didn't settle down or come back home as Gemini demands of you, your soul demands on you that you teach, that you teach others, that you share, that you're involved in the details and the facts. So you asking me about details and facts is on point. On point for me because I have an opposite South Node situation where I need to go into philosophies and beliefs and my beliefs on things. But it is proper for you to collect facts and details and then share them in quick ways with people. And get this, return home. Gemini North Nodes aren't necessarily supposed to travel the world forever. It would start to feel like something's off. And when we behave in our South Node behavior too long, it's kind of like, I describe it as like a squishy brown sofa. It's your comfort zone, your South Node. It's what you're really, really good at. I mean, nobody's a better traveler than you. Nobody's better at learning from different cultures and developing philosophy about things. And you could go on dissertations about the things you've seen. But Gemini is about asking other people who have different beliefs what they think. It's about being involved in local community. It's coming home. And that is what you're doing. So you are activated at the young age of 30 something. And then what we do is we take it further. We look at, you know, that's the North Node. So I have a course on the North Nodes. You can look it up for free on my website, just with your birthday. You don't need to have your time. Not everyone has your birth time. In order to look further at the second half of it, what I call is what house placement it's in. And I don't want to make it too complicated. It's not. I'm just going to tell you, yours is in the seventh house of partnerships. So it tells me your soul's going to be happy when you are doing all these Gemini things, teaching, sharing information, settling into your community, home where you are. That's why you came back home. I mean, you went to make babies in the world, but you come back. That's where you're supposed to be for your soul's happiness. So basically what happens when you act out of your, when anyone acts out of their South Node, which happens at any given trigger time in our lives or whatever, people trigger it. It's like being in a squishy brown sofa because it's your comfort zone. You know how to do it. You excel at it, but you get too comfortable and the room starts getting darker. You feel off. People can feel you're off, but nobody knows why. It's because you're acting according to your South Node. It's time to get up out of the sofa, reach and stretch and grow towards your North Node. So yours is in the seventh house of partnerships. So if you behave like a Gemini, which is being the charming person that you are, interested in other people, teaching, sharing in your local community, and being in partnership, your spirit's going to be happy. So well done.
Seems like there's a lot of layers here.
Well done. I mean, I can always look further and deeper and help navigate in further, you know, how to get greater success and how to be heard and what your midheaven is, who you are on the world stage. But that's like the basics. So when I do a session for someone, the first thing I'm like, what's their North Node? Because it's like a secret to knowing your soul's wish. You don't need all that. It's like you go for that. And then I can help you like get to that. Your beautiful wife has a double Taurus. She has a lucky placement. She's here to enjoy beautiful things. She needs to provide for herself. And she has the North Node place. It's getting too complicated. We can do North Node in another class, but it's really fun to see. So you're on point.
So when I was poking around in this map, you know, we were saying like it could inspire you to go a certain place. One thing I noticed was there's like lines going crisscrossing everywhere for me in Iceland. And I thought, oh, that seems like a messy place. There's a lot of lines.
And yeah, when that happens, It's messy. So it's messy. When there's a lot of lines, it does, when there's one line, that's it. You got that planetary line and it's affecting you in this certain way and it's big and it's bold. Then if you have two lines, it means that there's like, if they're conjunct meaning next to each other, or they're crossing, or they're very close, then it would mean that those two energies combined make their own energy, like they make a baby. When there's more than three or more lines, then each line gets a little bit diluted. And when there are that many lines, it's just a cacophony of like, what's going on here? I have never been in a place with that many lines. I've spoken to people who've lived on or near, and it's just a lot. You'd be pulled in a lot of directions, let's just say. It wouldn't just be super clear. But at any given moment in time, depending on who you are and what you need to do, this is where the information becomes so exciting, is that when you know your lines and you know that you have Jupiter there, you can lean into the Jupiter energy, understand if there's something poorly affecting you, and say, all right, I got this. I can take this on. If you know you're living on a Pluto line and you know that it's pretty badass, then you know to bring it on, like bring it on. And you also know to get out of town when necessary to lighten up because it's heavy. So for me, it's never saying don't go anywhere. It's just saying this might be more challenging. And now you'll know there's some certain challenges that would be a challenging area for you.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah. Cause I was like, oh, maybe I won't go there right away if I want an easier time.
No, it wouldn't be like easy peasy, you know, it'd be like lots going on, but they also dilute themselves. But I don't think that an astrogeographer would say, hey, go live there. That's kind of like, you know, it's interesting that you said Spain it's what I do when I look and if someone's thinking of relocating or really being somewhere for an extended period of time, you know, up to 2 weeks, it could take one day. You could feel it the minute you land. I had a friend who felt prickles on the back of his neck and somewhere where he landed, and he got back on the ferry and left. And I looked and it was a Pluto line. Sometimes it could take up to 2 weeks. Pluto can feel sexy or, you know, it could take, depending on how much you've been imbibed with the energy of what you've been living on, how much you're carrying, how sensitive you are, depends on how fast you'll feel it. So how long were you in Portugal for?
We did 3 months in Portugal.
That's a significant amount of time. I don't think that you like that moon eye sea line. I wouldn't want to be on a moon line. It makes you moony and too in touch with needs and desires. And I really think you're here not to be moony. You're here to be intellectual. Gemini is a very intelligent North node choice. It's like you're here to be mercurial, to be the messenger, not to sit home and be moony. It's good for you to be with family, but it's not your trajectory is to be in partnership. Your trajectory is to be mercurial with others and share. So being moony is too home. It's too home for you, especially at this age and stage. I think you're going to feel really good in the middle of the States. And we can always check in with me after the podcast because we have to share a screen and I can point out stuff.
Yeah. And I'm curious if you have picked certain areas to go explore based on this and what your experience was.
Now I know too much because well, it's funny, even though I know too much. So this past summer, I know for my life's trajectory, I do need to travel the world. And if I get too comfortable at home in my local community, it's time to go because I need to travel. So I was like, all right, I'm packing up my house and the Airbnb and I'm out. And I was going for 2 weeks to 3 months. I didn't know. And I said, I have to pick a place. So the word Rome came to me and I'm like, Rome. And I was like, Rome. And then it was like, I looked around at other places and nothing was speaking to me. And all I kept hearing was Rome. And I was like, it's a Neptune line. Really? Like that's the line that I had to fight to move away. I was like, well, you know, I know how to work with this. I had all my Jupiter expansive energy that I feel here. So I'm totally optimistic. And I think I'm going to feel the benefits of Neptune. So there's, for every planet, there's the high side and there's the low side. Neptune is the ultimate, it's like divine love. It's like tapped into spirituality. It's arts, it's beauty, it's music. And I thought, I'm just going to feel romantic there. Well, not so fast, Missy. In a combination, I did go to Rome and I did make videos of this experience and it was awful. it was like Neptune, the god of the sea, just went, okay, you, and just dunked me underwater, combined with jet lag. I think that was part of it. After about a month and a half in Rome, I started to get acclimated. I worked with the energy. I did some certain things to make myself feel seen, but I literally felt invisible there. I felt like I was underwater, and it was an absolute confirmation of what I know to be true about Neptune. But I listened to my intuition. I think there was some karmic things, a moon's node line there. So there was karma to be healed there. I ended up meeting a past life regressionist who did a session with me. Like, I had to go there. Even though I knew better, I still went there because my spirit called me there. And I learned a lot. And then I went to Greece because my daughter wanted me to go to Greece. And I had some other lines that were tricky. And I was going to just head home. I'm like, after 2 months of this, I was like, maybe it's just time to go back to my Jupiter line. And I kept getting messages from this woman on Instagram who kept going, Lisbon, Lisbon. And she kept sending me pictures. If I tell you, like, hundreds of pictures throughout my trip, I was like, all right, universe, I'm hearing. I can't end this trip on a spiral of like, okay, I tried some astrogeography lines. They were on point. It wasn't so great. I mean, I had a beautiful time, but it wasn't the easiest. And I went to Lisbon, which was also a Jupiter line, but a different angle. So I live on a Jupiter rising line. So that's me being Jupiterian, me being optimistic. Lisbon was close to a Jupiter midheaven line. So that's me being Jupiter herself and the society throwing it back at me. When I got there, everyone was smiling at me in the streets. It was lucky. It was happy. I was able to finish what I intended to take my North Nodes. I was developing the North Nodes course, the life tool, and I wasn't quite done with it in Venice. And I said, oh, I'll finish it in Europe. I wasn't able to even answer an email on my Neptune line. I didn't care. It was just like, I'm just going to float out to sea and give this all up. When I got to Lisbon, I hunkered myself in the Airbnb for 3 weeks and I was able to finish my course. And I was happy and I'm going back to Lisbon. So that's my experience has been, you know, if I go to Israel where I have Saturn and Pluto, let's see what happens. But I'm not afraid. I just know to know enough to say, okay, it gets weird, time to go. You know, that kind of thing. Pay attention to the energy. But if you are drawn to a place, I do believe it holds something that needs to come up and out, that needs to be addressed. So there's nothing to be afraid of, really, except there are some warning lines, you know, Mars descending. You could have a warning come with that one. Could be a warning come with a Pluto line and a Saturn line. But some people need that. They need that Saturn energy. So
well, thank you for sharing that. We got Rome, Greece, and Lisbon and three different experiences. So that's super cool. I'm just noticing that time. I have a couple of questions. I notice we're like at the end of the hour.
Yeah.
How are you on time?
I'm fine. I'm happy to answer.
Okay, cool. Well, I'm wondering if you could recommend a place where I should travel to.
I think you are very, very, very lucky from like Baja, San Diego, all the way up through Arizona, up through Utah, through Colorado. I mean, there's an arc there of those three colorful lines that are going to give you serious benefic energy. And for your particular North Node in Gemini, anytime you see a Mercury line, it's a green and it looks like it's got little antlers on its head. It's the green line with a little cross at the bottom. Those Mercury lines, except for Mercury, I see. So I would recommend, because you now have the course. So you are going to look for the bright green line that's Mercury. And I show it all in the course. You're going to look for Mercury rising. It's going to make you more mercurial, more intelligent. When you find a Mercury DS line, you're going to meet people who spark your intellect and spark your communication. And to have notoriety for the work that you do, to be written about, to be seen as the communicator that you are and the teacher, then I would say that Mercury with the MC underneath the midheaven would be so very good for your soul's wish. And I would also look to any Venus line because of your placement of your North Node, because you need more partnership. Partnership is really good for you. You've had a lot of Mars energy in past lifetime, and you've had a lot of Jupiter. Like, you don't necessarily need Jupiter. You have that because of that Sagittarius South Node, which is sounding all too complicated to you all, I'm sure. So just glaze over and know that anybody really, it's partnership in love, in business, in coaching. You know, a good DS line is excellent if you are in the business, if you are helping others, if you want to have good relationships with others. Amazing. So it's legal, it's life coaching, it's psychologist, it's long-term friendship, and definitely love partnerships. And with anybody wants more fame and reputation in the world, you included, to be seen is so nice, to be seen for what you're currently wishing to be seen as. So it doesn't necessarily mean you have to be on TV. It just means that you'd like some recognition for the work that you do and who you are. Any sun line, a sun line, especially a sun midheaven, the MC, the sun rising, the AC, and the sun descending is going to give you generosity and laughter and partnership. I can't wait to listen to the course and the videos, and you can ask me questions. And
yeah, so for the listener, I'll be going through the course, so I can also talk a little bit more about that in the show notes. We already talked a little bit about how to bring the energy of these places in if you can't travel, which is also helpful because, you know, we can't always just go somewhere. And I'm wondering if you have any final thoughts you'd like to wrap with, anything that we haven't touched on that you think is important to know.
I do. I do need you to know that Japan and Australia, Adelaide and East, are stellar for you.
Adelaide and East. So I lived in Australia for a while. I lived in northern Australia. Japan. Okay. Stellar.
Yeah. I mean, we can talk about that. I love your north. Confuse people, but there's beautiful lines there for you and other places in the world as well, which I'm happy to touch upon with you. But in general, I want everyone to know that it's just so simple. Like, sometimes people make things seem so complicated, but you just take one piece at a time. It's kind of like, if you want to eat healthy, just learn how to make that one green smoothie in the morning and make that every day for 2 weeks until you're ready to learn the next piece. You know what I mean? You learn what your north node is. You watch that video. You're like, all right, I'm going to pay attention to this. And then when you're ready for the next piece, you do more. Like, it doesn't, I really want to demystify these things because they're tools that are clearly coming up for us to use to make our lives better. So if this sounded complicated to you, just know that it's like, take a deep breath and anyone can do this, can be done. And it's fun to know. So all of those years that I had heard that I had a Jupiter line in California and a Neptune line in Florida, can you imagine 20 years went by when I didn't know how to do this? Like, all of a sudden I was like, I have to know how, because I needed to be able to look up places. And I'm like, I started doing sessions for people. I'm like, everybody needs to know how to do this and understand it. So I think I explained it a little more fully, and I explain it like astro.com gives you, you can click on the lines and you're going to use that as a tool, but to understand it fully and how to incorporate it, the course is great. So I say, keep it simple and first find your birth time. And if you don't know your birth time, you can't do the astrogeography because you need your birth time. Definitely try and find your birth certificate. The other thing is, there is something called astrological rectification. And on my site, I list an astrologer who does that, so that based on major life events, you can work backwards and she can come up with a very close time of birth that will help you. She's excellent. Barbara. So that is something, and that at the very least you can know your north node and you can get that video, and it's going to like help you so much in your direction in life.
Amazing. Yeah, super cool.
So link, I gave you a special link where you're going to have a special code, and I'm really happy to be able to talk about this with you. I wish I had a podcast because I want to know about you. So if you want me to interview you on your podcast, I'm happy. I really want to know, because I think we're in sync. I think we're helping people expand their, I know I'm helping them expand their horizons. And I know, can you tell me a little bit about what you do for people?
Yeah, that's a great question. And thanks for asking me to plug my own stuff on my own show.
Yeah, I'd like to, because this is a website too. And I want people that get introduced to you through me, and maybe somebody wants to hear a little elevator pitch.
Yeah, so for listeners of the show, besides the show, I do coaching with entrepreneurs and thought leaders. We've got these adventure trips that we do from time to time, adventure quest, the adventure side of things. I'm working on a lot of books, that transfer of all the things that I'm learning. So I'm writing books myself. The next one is about transformational experiences and how they build leaders and change our identity. So that's really exciting. We just put out our volume 2 of this best-selling series of all my coach friends and I, we write our best exercises and we publish them in these books. So now we've got two volumes in total of 80 different exercises that people can go through on their own that have been refined by these coaches. And it's really amazing to see people out there using these exercises. Yeah, so that's really fun.
Well, I'm just going to put it out there for your adventure travel. Let's say you have a group that's going on travel. You could be like, these are the lions. This is what you might be feeling. We're going to support you in that. So it's great stuff. And I really thank you for your work.
Yeah, well, thanks for coming on the show. This is really fun. And thanks to the listener for, this is a fairly new format that we're doing. We're exploring something right here, essentially live. So you're experiencing it as I'm experiencing it. So you're along for the ride. Dara, thank you so much. Where can people find you?
Well, I'm on Instagram, Dara Dubinet. I have my website, daradubinet.com. And I have a YouTube channel, Dara Dubinet. So come join me. It's a family. It's a global family. For the Dara umbrella, and you like what I'm up to, you're going to like the
people who
are part of the family. And it's amazing to me. That's the favorite thing I've done, is that I could, show up in India to, when I was 49, I went to India to set up my solar return for the year. I went and I met people who were part of my YouTube family in India, and we spent 9 days together. So it's a global family. We are all one, and we're all just getting to the next level. We are just moving energy and making life better.
That's so cool. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks.
All right.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right, fascinating stuff with Dara Dubinet. If you learned something today, or if you had a takeaway, or you found this was just fascinating, go ahead and thank Dara for coming on the show and for her work. You can find her on YouTube, on Instagram. I can't remember exactly how I first got in touch with her, but she was someone that I didn't know before reaching out for this interview. And, that's something that I really enjoy and appreciate, the fact that I can reach out to many of these guests and start a relationship with them and have them on the show. And many of these people become repeat guests. You've seen that we've had guests coming on the show again and again, and we meet up different places around the world, and we do business together, and we have fun, and we travel together. And so if you want to, I've got actually, I wasn't planning on talking about this, but I've got a course about strategic relationships and building authentic long-term relationships and adding value to people. What most people do is they just take the relationships that they're given in life, their neighbors and their coworkers and people at their church and softball team and all these things. But you can learn to proactively go out and find the people that you want to be working with, the people that you want to be interacting with, learning from, mentors and all of these things. And so in the course that I have created last year on strategic relationships, we dive into exactly how you can grow and build and establish these relationships. And these are dream relationships. They say you're the average of the five people that you spend the most time with. But really, that concept is, where is your attention? What inputs do you have? And the people that you're spending time with provide a lot of those inputs and context for your external experience. So you can check that out. You can go to my website, DerekLoudermilk.com. You can find that course, because we've got this pandemic going right now, and it's super important that you take advantage of this time to increase your skills, make yourself more rare and valuable. I'll be running a special discount over there. I'm not sure exactly what it is yet, but you can go check that out. We'll probably knock it off 50% for you guys. So yeah, great opportunity for you to get ahead no matter what you're learning. It doesn't have to be my course. Look for the opportunity. Look for the bigger picture if you're stuck at home in quarantine and wondering what you should do. Don't binge on Netflix all day. Get ahead if you want. All right, so that's all for today's episode. Thanks so much for listening. Now it's your turn to go out there and be adventurous.